blessed today to be able to have Lisa Campion sharing with us. She's basically a modern day wizard. I was reading her bio and it absolutely blew me away. She's a psychic counselor and Reiki master. She's trained over 1,000 people in Reiki, which is like, when you think about the impact that's had on our planet, I mean, that's fascinating. She has conducted over 15,000 individual Reiki sessions, which when I read that, I was like, wow. So pretty much like all the time she's doing Reiki on someone, which is just like, you think about the people that come into like a Reiki session, that people like us. So she's touching a lot of people and supporting a lot of people that are just like us. She's the Dean of Students at the Rhys Thomas Institute, which is a 3-year energy medicine school that is also training people in energy. And she has a best-selling book out called The Art of Psychic Reiki, which I can't wait to read. She's also the host of a popular radio show called The Miracle of Healing on Empower Radio. So, I mean, she's a true light worker, and I am so blessed, and I want everyone to give a warm welcome to Lisa. Welcome to our group.
Thanks, Kyle. That was so sweet. That was such a nice introduction, and it's beautiful to see you all this morning. Thank you for having me here, and thank you to the host of the podcast, and thank you for sharing this beautiful Mother's Day in May with me. I so appreciate it. So because it's Mother's Day, I really wanted to talk about mothering. It's a triggering thing for a lot of people, and it's sort of one of those things like, oh, happy Mother's Day. We think about Hallmark cards and champagne brunches, or, you know, breakfast is out with our mothers. We think about, you know, that's what we see on Facebook, and the reality, it can be very bittersweet for people. So I'm blessed to have a wonderful mother that's still with us, and I feel really, really lucky about that. And I'm also a mother. I have 3 adult children who are doing well and thriving, and I am extremely lucky and grateful for that too. And I know it's not always that way. Like, there are people here who you maybe have lost your mother. Maybe your mother has lost a child. Maybe you want to be a mother, and Kevin, that hasn't happened for you. Or maybe you were unmothered or not mothered very well. And so what I want to do today is talk about all of that and to find a way to kind of discuss that, work that through, and honor all of the women that have honored us, our actual mothers, our adopted mothers, our grandmothers, our aunties, our soul mothers, and also the OG mother, the earth herself. We're gonna take some time to honor her too. So anyway, thank you for sharing the day with me. And mothering, you know, is such a primal thing, like such a primal need. And what do we do? I mean, Kristen was talking about that in the beginning, you know, when she was talking about her relationship with her mother. And so I'm just gonna talk for maybe 20 minutes here. And then we're going to do a meditation at the end to help us connect and maybe heal some of our mother stuff, mother lineage, and then connect to the Mother Earth. And I wanted to talk about sort of the light and dark side of this whole mother thing, the mother archetype. So in the work that I do, I work a lot with archetypes. And Carl Jung started talking about archetypes, you know, 100 years ago, and they're so powerful to work with because they help connect us to that primal part of us that's in the back of our brain, that's in our limbic brain, the middle brain, and actually the limbic brain has a lot to do with how we were mothered, because it develops, that part of the brain develops when we're nursing or being bottle fed or being held by our mothers, and so that can, the wiring in that part of our brain can go kind of awry when we're not nurtured as really young babies. And we can also heal that. So we're going to talk also about how to heal if we haven't had a great experience with our mothers. So archetypes, you know, I think they conjure up some images in our mind when we talk about archetypes. So for example, you will all have sort of the similar kind of thing pop into your head if I talk about the archetype of a clown. You'll all have a common kind of understanding of what that is, or a princess is another archetype. when I say that, or queen, knight, you know, king, fool, these are all kind of archetypes, and so is mother and father. They're very, very powerful archetypes. And when we work with, when we do archetype work, we're always working with two sides of things. There's the light side and the shadow side of any archetype. And in fact, as people, we inhabit the light and shadow side of those archetypes too. So your mother had a light side and a dark side to her, and it, you as a mother, if you are a mother, or a parent, is going to also have those things too. So perhaps there are some of you that have had absolutely perfect mothers. And if that, if so, I totally want to honor and celebrate that. We're going to do a lot of honoring today because it's Mother's Day. And if you are a mother or a parent at all, you're going to understand now, you know, that there's no such thing as a perfect parent. We're just human beings. We're doing the best that we can. And when we try, really hard, we can sort of aim for a good enough parenting. And like, you know, you might be able to see as an adult that your mother was a good enough mother, even if she wasn't perfect. You might come to a kind of forgiveness and understanding that your mother was doing the best that she could with what she had, and that she is, you know, was dealing with the things that were passed down through her lineage, just as you are now doing that. Now, what's really interesting about this, I think, is that even though there's this deep part of us in that limbic brain, and that limbic brain I was talking about before, which is the feeling brain, it's the middle brain, it's the animal brain, really always longs for perfect mothering. You could be 80 years old and you're still going to be longing for that part of our brain wants this sort of perfect idealized mother. And that is the mother that sort of automatically knows what you want and gives it to you as sort of psychic and magical and completely attuned to you. And we never stop wanting that. But real child psychologists will tell us that even though we want that, it's not very good for us to receive perfect mothering. If we could wave a magic wand and have received 100% perfect mothering, like every single need was met, there was never any friction, there was never any problems. Well, what would happen is you would have an adult that was completely incapable of managing life on their own, right? So it's in this friction or these gaps or these spaces where things aren't perfect that we kind of grow. That gives us the friction we need to grow into who we are. And also there, I don't think we have time to talk about it today, but it would be another great topic for another episode maybe, of inner child work, because there's a part of us that always stays a child. So we have a child archetype inside of us that will, our inner child gets sort of frozen or locked in various parts of time, especially when we receive trauma. So part of your healing work is, that's important, is to do some inner child work to go back and work through the tangles, the frozen pieces, the traumas that get locked up and held in inside of our own child archetype. So, and the child archetype in you is so important. So the child archetype in you holds the most beautiful part of you. It holds the purest essence of your soul. It's like where the soul is the freest expression of who you are. And I love it that some of you guys have kids running around behind you, because we can see in those children, you can see the like ensoulment. You can see the purity of the soul in a child, and how that flows through us in terms of play and spontaneity and love and joy and this ability to fully process our feelings in the moment. And even if you're old and cranky now, you still have that inner child, and doing this work on your child and freeing yourself and healing from your parent, how you were parented, can open us to the beauty and the light of the child that's within us. So I do think it's so interesting, you know, that our that child psychologists say like it wouldn't really benefit you to have been perfectly mothered, even though our limbic brain really wants to. And I just say that's also as a benediction and absolution to all of you that are parents, to try and let yourselves off the hook of being perfect parents, because you can't. Don't even try, but you can be good enough. You can be always improving. You can be, and also seeing how your imperfections are creating your children to be who they are. Now, I believe in past lives. You don't have to, so that's okay, but just roll with me here for a little minute. And I, in my viewpoint, we actually have chosen our parents, who our parents are, and you, just as your children chose you, when we are in that in-between space, in-between life, so when we're in heaven, soul world, wherever, however you want to say that, we will have actually picked our parents. And I know that some people find that scary and strange, because if you had really terrible parents that abandoned you or neglected you or abused you, you may be like, why did I choose that? How could that even be true? But the way that I see it is that our parents, our siblings, our children, our mates, our primary partners are always part of our soul family. So we have a soul family. We don't just have one soulmate. We have an entire tribe, a soul tribe. And what we do is we create contracts with those people before we come down here. And truthfully, we give our usually most difficult and painful lessons to our most beloved soulmates. So let's say, for example, you're hanging out in heaven in soul world with your tribe, and you're deciding to come down here on the planet for a life. And you think, okay, this is a life where I really want to continue to work through my abandonment issues. So I know I've been like, this is like lifetime number 10 where I'm working through my abandonment issues, but I'm going to come back there and do it. So you look around, through your soulmates, and you're like, well, I need somebody to just abandon the heck out of me, because when we're, trying to learn something about these big life lessons that we have, we need to actually experience every single point on the continuum. So you will have lives where you were the abandoner, you will have lives where you are the abandoned one, and we swap around these roles with our soulmates all the time. So you might say to your favorite soulmate, like, look, I know this is really rough for you, but let's have a life together, and you can be my mother and just abandon the heck out of me. And that person that's your mother's like, oh, I don't really like that. That's so hard for me because I love you so much. But, you know, I need to experience the other side of it. So I, out of very great love for you, my darling, I will choose to do that. And, you know, there we have it. There we have it. It's like that will give both of the people inside of that contract the experience, the friction, and also the ability not just to wound each other, but also the ability to possibly work it through and resolve those patterns to a higher level. Because every time we have another lifetime, we're always evolving, we're always improving, we're always coming to a higher level of beauty, order, and harmony in ourselves and with the world. So, you know, you might have had a really difficult parenting experience, but, you know, when you get back to soul world, you might, you know, slap that person a high five and be like, you know, thanks, excellent job. You really put me through my paces, and you know, I'm better for it. And we can look at these patterns, you know, when we take that sort of archetypal view, we can really look at these things and say, you know, what did your parents teach you? So this is our parents give us the light and the dark gifts. So we talked about the light and dark sides of the archetypes. And the light that we experience or that we absorb from both of our parents, you could look at both your parents and see, and when I say parents, it could be adoptive parents, foster parents, you know, parents of choice, bio parents, like however that is for you. We absorb the light of both sides of them, of our parents, and also some of the shadows of both sides of our parents. So what did they pass you directly? Maybe you got your dad's sense of humor and your mom's ability to make lemonade out of lemons. Right? So I want you just for a moment now to sort of think about that. Think like, what did you get that was really great from both of your parents, especially from your mother, since it's Mother's Day? So let's just take a moment and honor the light gifts that your mother delivered to you directly. What was great about your mother that you have gotten? You know, maybe it's your intelligence or your humor or your adaptability. Maybe it's your independence or your curiosity. But there's also the shadow side of that. And the shadow, we call them challenges. We experience them as wounds. And these things are the things that we learn due to the friction we get from our parents. And for example, maybe even those wounds and those shadows have a gift to them. they have something that, that friction, it's sort of like lifting weights, you know, or going to boot camp. I always say like your childhood is the boot camp you went to that turned you into the person you, you are now, so that you have the strength and all of the tools and gifts you need to complete your life purpose. And boot camp's not that fun, you know what I mean? But boot camp makes the person you need to be. And you can also look at the difficulties, the dysfunctions that you've had in your family and see where the boot camp was. See how can you open your mind to the possibility that those things were exactly designed by you to create the person that you are now in order to give you your mission, in order to give you the strengths and your tools. Even your pain is like the rocket fuel that you need to do what you came here to do. So for example, maybe you were a latchkey kid like I was, right? And I would come home from school. It's really common in my generation. Come home from school, there was nobody ever there. There was like a note and a sandwich under a plastic wrap and see you at dinner, right? And maybe, you know, like I got that. I learned independence and self-reliance, which I've needed my whole life. If you had, you know, a mother who was depressed, you might have learned nurturing or caretaking or compassion. If you had abuse or difficulties, you might have learned the power of anger and how that can be a fuel for you to set boundaries and say no, and sort of rocket fuel for your life. Energy, anger is like a really powerful form of energy. And maybe you had parents that were so dysfunctional that they required you or forced you to set a boundary and say no, and thereby step into your power, right? So I want you to take a moment and just contemplate this shadow, the shadow gift that you got from your mother. Even if it was only, I am never going to be like that, you know, even if what we do is we swear I'm going to do everything I can do to not be like that. So for me, I hated being a latchkey kid so much that I just put my foot down and refused to do it. I stayed home with my kids, even though it was really challenging. It was a huge commitment. It was economically difficult to do that. But I think that it drove me to a good place, or I chose to do that, that was the shadow gift my mother, or one of the shadow gifts my mother gave me, even though she gave me a ton of light gifts too. So take a moment again to honor that shadow, the shadow gift that your mother gave you, and see if you can make the connection to how it strengthened you. Right? Here's another interesting way to think about this, is that how your mother loved you is often how we learn to love and nurture ourselves, for good and for bad. So you can see, if you had a really nurturing mother, you would know how to nurture yourself. If you didn't have a very nurturing mother, you may find it really difficult to nurture yourself. That may be something you need to learn. And our relationship with our fathers tends to model our relationship with other and the world. So you can think about not just our romantic relationships, but all other people and the world. So if you had a father that was there and easy to connect with, it may be easy for you to do that. And if you didn't, that might be a challenge for you. And also, this is a shocker, it's sort of a trippy concept, but how your parents connected in love to each other will have formed the template for how you relate to your primary partnerships. And it can either be a beautiful romance or an epic train wreck. And I don't know, somehow we picked these things. Somehow we chose to be modeled. It's like when we're a child, we receive the imprinting of our parents and our family and our childhood. We get stamped, we get molded, imprinted with that stuff in a way that forms us. And then as adults, we take that and work with it in all the ways that we do. So it's super important. Clearly, it's super important that at some point in your life, you take time to clean up any trauma that you've had in your childhood. Otherwise, you run the risk of endlessly repeating these patterns, right? So we've all got to, at some point, open up to that healing. Maybe we do therapy. Maybe we join support groups. Maybe we do body work. Maybe we do energy work. or spiritual work, I find, especially with these parenting, our family of origin things, we really need to work it on all levels, mind, body, spirit, energy, in order to empower ourselves, in order to let go of the trauma. Because I think pretty much everyone comes out of childhood with trauma. I met a few people that had like super idealized, very ideal childhoods, but most of the people that I've worked with in the 30 years that I've been working have something that's really difficult that they're working through. So in order to come out of that trauma, and if we stay in the trauma, then it kind of can leave us feeling victimized, angry, blaming, recreating the patterns, recreating the mess, in order to block that pattern and really step into the light side of this, the light side of your gifts and the light side of your own archetypes, we have to clean that stuff up. So get some healing work if you need it. Therapy is fantastic for digging up our unconscious patterns of our life that gets downloaded. So these unconscious patterns, the patterning of our family, is like computer program that gets downloaded. It's like the operating system that gets installed on your computer. That's your brain. And until we do a lot of really deep inner looking, we run those programs in a very unconscious way, repeating the dynamics of our family without really knowing we're doing it, and you know, continuing sort of the dysfunction as we go forward. But once we examine those patterns, we can make choices, we can see it consciously, we can choose whether or not we're going to participate in them, we can choose to accept the light and heal the shadow sides of things. There is an incredible modality, if you don't know about it, called family constellations. It's also sometimes called the Hellinger work. And what this kind of work does is it deals what's called the legacy wound. Since we're not only dealing with our past lives and our soul contracts with people, we're also dealing with the legacy wound. And that is the, it's sort of these combination of mental patterns, thoughts, feelings, and experiences, mindsets, and now even we know genetics that gets passed down through generations. So there is something called epigenetics, which is a science pioneered by Dr. Bruce Lipton. And what they've done is they've found that certain kinds of traumas change our DNA, literally change our DNA in a way that gets passed down to our offsprings. It can be traumas like war, famine, disease, abuse, incest, alcoholism. All of these things, violence of all kinds, change our DNA in the moment when we're receiving that trauma, and then we pass that down to our children. And the scientists believe that that happens with the hope that we are now have evolved our DNA in a way that's better able to adapt to whatever that is, right? So we get this sort of whole energy packet from our lineage, and people that study this kind of legacy trauma, it's super interesting work. I've always been interested in it. You know that old saying, the sins of the father last seven generations? It does seem that it is seven generations. So you might be in the middle of dealing with something that happened four generations ago, like your grandparents or your great grandparents, that is created this intense energy or situation in your family lineage that you are then going to pass to your kids and then to their kids. And so at some point, somebody inside of that family stands up and starts doing some healing work. My guess is if you're on this call, it's you. It's you that's doing that. So let's take a moment to honor that part of you, the spiritual warrior that stands up and sort of says, okay, I'm going to deal with this. I'm going to deal with this thread that's in my family. And as you stand up and heal it, you are healing for your past generations, you're healing for the past, and you're healing also for the future generations. So it's very powerful spiritual warrior work to do this kind of the healing that I know you guys are all doing. So take a minute to think about the constructs that are in your family that you're working on healing right now. And they can be beliefs. So beliefs like beliefs about abundance, like money is the root of all evil, or good people work until they drop in the saddle, right? It might be kind of prejudices. We love or hate this kind of person. We might have emotional legacies, like, well, we never get angry in my family, or we never cry, we stiff upper lip it. That's sort of a big one here in New England, So we have those kinds of mindsets and emotion sets that we get passed down. But we also have deeper wounds. And I'm sure you all have this. I have it in my family too. These legacy wounds are generational and they're very difficult. They're most difficult things that we have to deal with as people. They might be things like alcoholism, mental illness, incest, abuse, murder, suicide, exile, adoption. These are huge, big, big, big deal issues that tend to get passed down in generationally. So just the other day, I was working with three sisters. It was so interesting. They were all coming in for readings and we were doing energy work and stuff virtually. And they all had the similar issue. They all had problems with their housing. One of them was relocating for her job, and she would be moved all across the country, like every 2 years on the dot. She'd have to get up and relocate some crazy distance. The other one was struggling with paying her rent, and she would get evicted. She would get evicted, or she would have some crazy, you know, thing that forced her to move. The other one, I'm not kidding, her house was knocked down by a hurricane in Florida, and she would move, and like then the house would be flooded. Like, these three sisters had the worst luck around their housing. And when I looked at them, and especially as a family, as a kind of a, you know, unit, I could see this was a generational wound. This is one of those things. And I traced, so I'm looking through the past that they're just psychically at their generations and going, oh, wow, like, you know, four generations ago, your great grandparents, what was going on there? They have exile karma. And they told me that they were from a part of the world where there was a war going on then, and everyone had to pick up and move. Everyone got kicked out of their country, and they were exiled and never were able to go back to that country, and sort of wandered around looking for home and never really finding it. And that's one of these things that goes so deeply into the psyche and is so such a powerful thing that ever since then, every generation since then has had this issue of exile, of not being able to find a home, literally a home that they could settle into. So we started working on it. We started releasing those energies and clearing them up in them individually, and also for the family. And we could feel as we were doing that work that that was healing for their ancestors that had that original wound, and also healing for their kids. So hopefully that wouldn't be going on too. So this is an incredibly powerful kind of healing that we can do. So think about those big, giant, big mama dysfunctions and see if you can see the threads of that in your own lineage, in your own life, in your parents, your grandparents. Like, do some genealogy, like look back through those things. And as we're doing that kind of work, and whether it's spiritual work or family constellations, we can reclaim also these light gifts, of our family, and as well as healing the shadow aspects of it. So that's kind of the human side of the mother, the light and the dark side of the mother archetype. I also want you to take a little bit we're going to take a minute before we do our meditation here, of some images of the divine mother, because our mothers are imperfect. We love them when they're just humans, but we can access this unconditional, perfect mother energy. We can. That limbic brain is always clamoring for it, is always wanting it. And the place that we get it, there's two places where we can get it. That's not another human, really, is from the divine mother archetypes, like Mother Mary, Kuan Yin, Isis, and actually from the Mother Earth herself. Those two energies are available to us all the time. And when we learn how to tap into those, the divine mother archetype of the goddess and also the earthly energy, we can really nurture and satisfy and heal that part of us that just, no matter what you, no matter how old you are, you still want your mother. You still want your mother. You still want that perfect, loving, nurturing mother who just fills every need you have and gives you 100% unconditional love all the time. And when we learn how to tap into those two streams of energy, it sort of takes a lot of pressure off the actual people in our life that we're hoping that are going to give that to us, right? So So I want you to think about maybe some images that work for you of the Divine Mother. Maybe it's, like I said, Mother Mary. Maybe it's, think about any of the goddesses, right, that we have. You can buy a goddess deck. I know Kristen sells them in her store. You can think of, you can just look up archetypes of the mother so that you can tap into that flow and really get it on a primal level. Here's another really interesting thing about the Divine Mother, just from on a cosmic level, right? So we have the human images of the Divine Mother that we humanize, these archetypes we humanize that we think of as the pantheon of goddesses that are available to us. But on a cosmic level, the Divine Mother is the empty space that the universe popped into. Like, there had to be, I think of it as like the empty womb that existence created itself inside of, right? So this cosmic Divine Mother is the void, the emptiness, the dark space, the nothing space between the atoms, right? That something is born into. And when we learn how to tap that energy, which we can do in very powerful creator, kind of creator type meditations. My colleague Rhys Thomas does this powerful meditation called the Creator Meditation. You guys should have him on here sometime to do that, because it's really cool. We go into that darkness, into the void, into the empty space where that's, it's like the empty womb of the cosmic mother, where into that life sparks. So from that level, the yin of the cosmos, the mother, the female energy of the cosmos, is emptiness, the empty womb, and the masculine is substance, it's substance, existence, matter, right? So we can learn, it's kind of advanced cool metaphysics, spirit, and manifesting mojo, how to connect with the cosmic mother in order to manifest our hopes and dreams. Okay. And then on an earthly scale, we can connect to the Divine Mother by being in nature. So we have Mother Earth. Mother Earth is, you know, we say Father Sky, Mother Earth. Tap into that energy too. We need to, right? So let's figure out some actual ways that we can tap into these divine sources. Maybe you pray and you do a lot of Hail Marys and Blessed Bees. Maybe you go to church if you're a churchgoer and you sit in a ladies' chapel and light a candle. Maybe you get a goddess card, deck of goddess cards, and every day you pull goddess cards to look at the divine, all the forms of the divine feminine and divine mother. And we know that maybe you guys agree that this time we're in now, this time of the ascension, what's happening now is there's a balancing between the masculine and feminine polarities. It's part of, we're moving into what they call now the unity. So we had long ago the time of the matriarchy. We've just come out of like 10,000 years of the patriarchy. It hasn't gone that well, really. And now we're coming into the unity where everyone's being asked to access and evolve our own internal masculine and feminine, right? So part of this mother thing is feeling our own divine feminine. And even if you're a man, especially if you're a man, you can honor the goddess, the divine mother, by honoring the goddess in every woman that you meet. When you do that, that will bring out your divine masculine. And that's what you can do to help humanity evolve. That's what we can all do to help humanity evolve right now and take our highest form during the shift. So if you're a man, treat every woman you encounter as if they were your mother, your daughter, your sister, your beloved, a goddess that you can honor, revere, sanctify, right? And as you do that, you elevate her and also yourself too. And also, if you're a man, honor your own divine feminine. So we all have feminine and masculine inside of us, and men can do a lot to bring the world into harmony right now by honoring their feminine side. That is a side of you that feels compassion, empathy, care, the desire to nurture, that feels emotional, intuitive, sensitive, psychic, that feels interconnected, right? You need this. We need this. We as a collective need this. We as women need you to do this. And you need it for your wholeness and your balance. It's so full of gifts. It's so full of power, and you need it to balance yourself. And if you're a woman, listening, honor the goddess inside of you, right? Elevate your own inner goddess. Spend some time in ritual. Pay attention to the moon and the phases of the moon, since we find our feminine side often than that. Let your hair down. Dance, cry, sing, laugh, go and hang out with other women, right? And honor, honor women needs, your part of it is to honor the feminine side of men, right? And not shame them, not berate them for showing us their beautiful, sensitive sides. So we need to, that's our part of the bargain here, is to do that. And then then we also, before we're going to do our meditation in a minute, but the last thing we want to talk about is to honor our Mother Earth, right? So we know we were born from her, and to her we return. We honor her as the source of all life, of knowing that we couldn't live without her. We couldn't live without air and water, without fire, without the minerals, the earth, you know, the rocks and the plants and the crystals and the trees. From her, we get all of our needs met. We get food, we get shelter. All things come from her. We are our children, and we better be better children to our poor mother. We're very out of balance in our relationship with our Mother Earth. We're taking for granted her bounty. We're asking for more and more and more without respect or without giving back. And I don't mean you. I know you guys are not doing that, but we as a collective humanity are doing that. So how is your relationship with Mother Earth? What do you need to do to balance and fix it? What are you doing that you shouldn't do, that you know that you got to quit, maybe to come into balance with the earth? And what do you know you should do that you're not doing? Like, maybe you need to recycle, maybe you need to go vegetarian, maybe you need to go out and walk or lie on the ground or stare at the sky or be near the ocean, right? We can honor our mother, divine mother, by our earth mother, by getting out in nature, putting our feet on the ground, hugging a tree, laying with your back on the grass and just letting the earth energy embrace us. We honor the Mother Earth by understanding we are part of an interconnected web of life, and that we cannot, we're like single cells in the body of this bigger organism. And the more we live from that place, the more we're all going to thrive. So honor your mother. Honor your mothers all the ways that you can. All right. So thank you. I just want to thank Kyle for warming us up with such an awesome meditation, but let's do a little more. And if you can, put your feet on the floor or sit cross-legged. If you can, be a little upright. Uncross your arms and legs, because energy flows a little better when we do that. Unless you're cross-legged, that's fine. And we're going to just start with a deep inhale right into the heart and the belly. So breathe in the top of your head into your heart and your belly. And just sit in there for a minute, see if you feel relaxed, your heart and belly are loose and soft. And then on the exhale, you're going to breathe down into your tailbone. Find your tailbone. And then breathe again. Inhale in the top of your head, breathe into your heart and your belly. And on the exhale breath, you're going to drop that energy down, down like it's extending like the taproot of a tree. Through the chair, through the layers of the building, down, down, down into the earth. This is called the grounding cord, and it's one of the ways we stay connected to the earth. And breathe again, breathe into your heart and your belly. Find that grounding cord and make it really wide, like the size of a trash can. And on the exhale breath, we're just gonna breathe any stress, any tension, any pain, any fear, any emotion, down the grounding cord with a blessing and a prayer for the Mother Earth. We ask her to accept this and recycle it, to transform it, to transmute it. And now in the next inhale breath, I want you to imagine breathing up through this grounding cord, just like you were sucking up through a straw. We're gonna breathe, inhale up the grounding cord. We're gonna breathe up the light of the earth. This energy of the earth itself. It's called the light of the earth. And we're going to absorb that. So bring it up into your belly on your inhale breath. And on your exhale breath, let it spread out through your whole body. each inhale, bringing it up into your, now bring it up into your heart, and now let it spread out. And this light of the earth is like the warmest, most nurturing, perfect mother. This is where you get the perfect mother energy. This is the divine feminine, the mother who loves you unconditionally, the mother who's always there for you 24/7, the mother who's never had a bad thought and only wishes the best for you, the mother who sees everything about you and loves you anyway, 100%, and is only wishing for you to fulfill your full potential. You're going to breathe in and let it go into all of your organs in your body, into every chakra, up into your head, down to your very fingertips. Let it absorb into the very cells, this perfect mother energy, this divine mother. Bring it in. Let it fill any hole or empty space, any part of you that got unmothered or imperfectly mothered. Let this take its place and fill you. And into the cells now, into the DNA. It's almost like, to me, it looks like liquid. It's like honey. It's like warm liquid light. And into the space between the atoms in your own body, every aspect, all the way out through your energy field now, filled with this beautiful, divine, loving mother energy. This is available for you every all day, 24/7. Can never run out. You can never take too much. It's always there, 100% for you. And now that you're full of this divine mother energy, I want you to feel, imagine, pretend, visualize your mother is standing over your left shoulder. And if she's alive or dead, it doesn't matter. There she is. She's got her hand on your shoulder. And you can now feel her transmitting the light gifts to you. So we honor the beautiful gifts that she gave you. Her smile, her sense of humor, her loving heart. And we're also going to honor the shadow gifts that she gave you, and thank her for both. And you can allow the divine light of the earth energy to transmute any part of that darker energy, any part of the shadow, into its highest form. And then standing behind her is your grandmother and your aunties and your female cousins and your whole feminine lineage and your great grandmother and your great great and all your great aunties, all the way back. As far as you can see behind you, there's a line of women with their hands on your shoulder and not on each other's shoulders. And each one of them is giving you a gift, giving you the strength of your family, giving you the light side. And you're going to use this light of the earth energy to transmute any of the shadow gifts. And just allow yourself to feel for this moment the energetic truth of the power of your feminine lineage and your mother's. And maybe you thank them, maybe you bow, maybe you bless them, maybe you ask for their whatever healing they need. And let it all be purified by this very pure, unconditional light of the earth. Take a moment to absorb that. Take a moment to reconnect to the beautiful light of the earth, this unconditional divine mother. Refill yourself, reconnect to it, purify all of the human energy in this divine, in the fire of this divine energy. And then shift your heart back to the love and the gratitude for the earth, love and the gratitude for yourself, for the day, for this moment. And any extra energy you have, you're going to flush down the grounding cord. With an exhale breath, we give back extra energy back to the mother, back to the earth. And when you feel ready, you can open your eyes.